Everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel. It's me, Tala P. And for today's podcast, it's all about hematology. So for hematology's podcast, we will be dealing with the bleeding time test. And also, we are going to discuss some of the functions of the platelet that are very important in coagulation. So let's start. First is, what is bleeding time test? So bleeding time test, it usually determines how quickly your blood clots to stop the bleeding. And it's a basic assessment of how well your blood platelets work to form clots. Remember, how well your blood platelets work to form clots. So these platelets, they are the first cells that will react to a blood vessel injury. So whenever there is an injury to the vessel, to the endothelial linings, then these platelets will going to initiate platelet activities so that they will form platelet plugs in order to initially stop the bleeding. And they are going to seal off the wound to prevent more blood from escaping. And remember that these platelets, they are very important, or they play a vital role in both the primary and secondary stages of hemostasis. So in other words, this bleeding time test, it's a useful tool to test for platelet plug formation and capillary integrity. So it's a screening test for detecting disorders of platelet function, because this bleeding time, they are directly affected by the number of platelets and also the ability of platelets to form plugs, which are the functions of the platelet. And you take note that the principle, or the main principle of bleeding time, is that they are affected by a low platelet count, and the other one is they are also affected by dysfunctional platelets. So in other words, there are two clinical indications whenever there is a prolonged bleeding time. One is there may be thrombocytopenia or low platelet count, and the other one is there is thrombocythemia or defective platelet function. Because remember that bleeding time, it depends mainly on a normal platelet number and a normal platelet function. So whenever there is prolonged bleeding time, it may indicate whether thrombocytopenia or low platelet count, and the other one is thrombocythemia or defective platelet function. So that's for about what is bleeding time. And also in the bleeding time test, we have mentioned about the platelets or the thrombocytes. So now, what is the main role of platelet in coagulation? So these platelets, they perform two important functions in the hemostatic process. So number one, they form a plug that covers the break in the endothelial cell lining. And then the second one is, once the plug is formed, the platelet membrane provides the surface on which the activated coagulation proteins or the clotting factors bind. And for the platelet function in coagulation, in order for them to form these platelet plugs with a damaged vessel, there are five important steps that are involved during platelet interaction in order for them to form these platelet plugs. And once they are once the plug is formed, they can now initiate coagulation, because they will make this platelet surface available for the clotting factors to initiate now the coagulation, so that hemostasis or the stoppage of bleeding will occur continually. Okay. And for the steps of platelet interaction, in order for them to form platelet plug, these are the five important steps. Number one is contact. Second one is adhesion, spreading, ADP release, and aggregation. So for the contact of platelets, it's between the platelet and the damaged endothelial lining of the blood vessel. And after that contact has been made, the platelet will now adhere to the damaged surface. So there is adhesion. Thereafter, these platelets spread out along the damaged surface, changing its shape. Usually it's a flattened shape. So that is spreading. And they will now release an important chemical for aggregation, which is adenosine diphosphate. So this adenosine diphosphate, it will stimulate other platelets to aggregate to the area of the damaged vessel. So platelet plaque formation provides an effective barrier to further blood loss. And once this platelet is formed, because platelet plaque is only temporary, these coagulation proteins or the clotting factors then take up their role to ensure hemostasis now. So you remember these five important steps in order for this platelet to form plaques with a damaged vessel. There must be contact, adhesion, spreading, ADP release, and aggregation. And another important thing about the role of platelet in coagulation are the prostaglandins. So these prostaglandins, they regulate ADP release. So what are the examples of these prostaglandins that are very important for releasing adenosine diphosphate that is very important for aggregation? So number one is the thromboxane A2, and the other one is prostacycline or the PGI2. These two prostaglandins, they usually induce opposite effects, wherein this thromboxane A2, it's released by the platelet membrane and results in the release of adenosine diphosphate, which causes platelets to aggregate to the area of injury. While that of the PGI2, they are usually released by endothelial cells of the vessel so that ADP release is inhibited and platelets do not aggregate the area of injury. So this thromboxane A2 and that of the prostacycline, they provide checks and balances in platelet aggregation. If there are not enough platelets at the site of injury, no plaques will be formed. On the other hand, if too many platelets are present, the blood flow through the vessel is inhibited. So remember these prostaglandins that are very important for the release of ADP, which are thromboxane A2 and that of the PGI2 that induce opposite effects for this adenosine diphosphate. And now let's talk about what is a prolonged bleeding time, or what are the factors that usually affects the bleeding time test? So whenever there is prolonged bleeding time, there are two main clinical indications, and that is thrombocytopenia, wherein the platelet count is low, and the other one is thrombocythemia, wherein platelets are dysfunctional. So there are conditions wherein platelets are dysfunctional, such as von Willebrand disease, a fibrinogenemia, and other vascular disorders. So what are these functions of platelets that are usually affected? So it's either platelet secretion, platelet adhesion, and that of the platelet aggregation. And also a prolonged bleeding time test is affected by ingestion of aspirin or aspirin-containing compounds, anti-inflammatory drugs, anticoagulants, and some antibiotics. And take note that this bleeding time is the drug therapy is the most common cause of a prolonged bleeding time, and the most common is aspirin. So what do you need to remember about aspirin ingestion? Why it usually affects bleeding time test? Because aspirin, it will inhibit the enzyme cyclooxygenase. And this cyclooxygenase, it's very important for the formation of thromboxane A2. And that of the TA2 or the thromboxane A2, remember that it's an example of prostaglandin that usually released adenosine diphosphate. And that ADP or adenosine diphosphate, it's very important for the activity of platelet in order for it to form platelet plaque, and that is platelet aggregation. So you remember this flow. If aspirin is being ingested, what will happen? Cyclooxygenase enzyme is inhibited, and that of the thromboxane A2 is not formed, and that of the release of ADP will not occur, and platelet aggregation will not take place. Therefore, prolonging bleeding time because that of the platelet function is dysfunctional. And remember that bleeding time, it depends mainly on a normal platelet function. Now we proceed to the methods used for the bleeding time. So there are listed methods for the bleeding time test in this PowerPoint. So number one is Duke's method. The second one is IV method. Third is the template method, or it's a modified IV method by Mielk. And lastly is the simplate method. So for the first method, it's Duke's method. It's the easiest method to perform, but it's the least standardized and has the less precision and accuracy. So for this type of method, usually the puncture area is the earlobe, usually above the rounded fatty portion of the ear. And the incision size is 2 to 3 millimeter. And for the procedure for the Duke's method, all of the procedures, the wound is blotted every 30 seconds until bleeding stops or bleeding ceases. And the normal value for the Duke's method is ranging from 1 to 3 minutes. So this type of method for bleeding time is usually the easiest to perform because you're just going to prick the earlobe, or there is an alternative site for that because the earlobe, it's highly vascular. That's why it's not recommended as the puncture site. So an alternative site for that that we can use for the bleeding time determination test is the finger tip. Although it's the easiest to perform, but it's the least standardized and has the less precision and accuracy. What about the IV method? For the IV method, you are going to use an apparatus, which is the sphygmomanometer, and you're going to apply uniform pressure of 40 millimeter mercury. So you remember 40 mmHg. A blood pressure cuff is placed on the upper arm of the patient, and you're going to inflate that pressure cuff to 40 millimeter mercury so that it may control the capillary tone and to improve the sensitivity and reproducibility of the capillaries. It will maintain the constant pressure within the capillaries, and it will help standardize the procedure. So with the use of a sterile disposable blood lancet or scalpel blade, you're going to make a shallow incision, not too deep, not too shallow, that is 1 millimeter deep. So every 30 seconds, you're going to blot the filter paper, and the test will be finished if the blood stops completely. So usually the normal value for the IV method, it is 1 to 7 minutes. And what you should note about this method is that you should take note on the depth of the puncture or the incision, because it may be the source of error for this method for the bleeding time test. Another method for bleeding time is a modified IV by Mielk. So it's a modification of the IV method. It's known as the template method. It's a standard method for the bleeding time because you are going to use a template containing a standardized slit. Usually they call it barred Parker, or a similar disposable blade that is used along with a rectangular polystyrene or plastic template that contains a standardized slit. So the normal value for this Mielk method is 2.5 or 2 to 10 minutes or 2 to 9 minutes. And lastly is the simplate method. So simplate method, it's also known as the SurgiCat method, or it's another brand name for the simplate method. It's SurgiCat method. It's the preferred method for the bleeding time test, and it's the most standardized compared to other methods of bleeding time because you are going to use a simplate device that has a trigger and spring method for the blade. So the blade usually has a depth of 1 millimeter by 5 millimeter width. So you are just going to load that spring and then you're going to push the trigger and it will automatically incise the puncture area of for the bleeding time that is standardized already. So the blade is placed in a special handle containing a gauge in order to standardize the depth of the incision. It's the most standardized method for the bleeding time test. And for the normal value, it's 2 to 9 minutes also. But there are advantages and some disadvantages on using the methods MIELC or the template method, and the other one is the simplate method. So what are the advantages for the MIELC method or the modified IV method by MIELC? That the surgical incision more closely approximates the patient's hemostatic response to surgery compared to the puncture in IV method, and that the depth or of the incision can be controlled. But the disadvantage is that there may be patient's anxiety due to open blade, and small scars might form in using that MIELC method or the modified IV method. And the other one is for the advantages for the simplate method of the bleeding time test. Instrument is sterile, it's standardized, it's easy to use the device that makes a uniform incision. And instrument is a spring-activated surgical steel blade which is housed in a plastic unit. This eliminates variability of blade incision. And also this method is the most standardized method of all bleeding time procedures. And the disadvantage, it may leave a slight scarring to the patient. So you must inform the patient about the blade that you're going to use with the simplate method. So that's it for the methods for the bleeding time determination test. Another important thing that we must remember about bleeding time are the notes to remember that I've prepared. So these are the summaries. So number one note that you must remember about bleeding time, it's critical that you ask the patient whether or not they have taken aspirin or aspirin-containing compounds during the last 7 to 10 days, or other drugs that are considered to be blood thinners, such as heparin or coumarin recently. So if these patients have taken these aspirins during the last 7 to 10 days, this may, and you proceed with the bleeding time test. So these drugs may have or may cause a false abnormal prolonged bleeding time, and test should not be done. So you must take note on this aspirin ingestion. And number two, notes to remember about bleeding time. The critical value is more than 15 minutes. So if the puncture site still bleeding after 15 minutes, you discontinue the test and you apply pressure to the site, you document it and report the results to the clinician. So that's it. So the critical value for the bleeding time test is more than 15 minutes. So you must report it to the clinician and document about this result of the bleeding time test of the patient. And number three is the calibration. So for the calibration of bleeding time, there's no calibration that is usually performed, or the quality control procedure. Quality control, no external quality control is available for the bleeding time, because you must care must be taken to standardize the procedure. No external quality control. It's very important for you to take note or consider the depth of the incision, and you must standardize it by being extra careful in incising the puncture area, not too deep, not too shallow. And also for the sources of error, sources of error that may occur during the bleeding time test. So number one, if the patient has taken aspirin or aspirin-containing compounds during 7 to 10 days prior to the procedure, bleeding time may be prolonged. So the technician or the laboratory scientist must determine the patient's history concerning aspirin ingestion to ensure quality of results. And aside from aspirin, about 20 different medications may prolong bleeding time, including antihistamine, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, ibuprofen, and many more. And number two, the results may be affected by improperly performed puncture. So a puncture that is too shallow, too deep, or inappropriate puncture for the bleeding time will adversely affect the test results. So you must be careful in incising the puncture area of the bleeding time test. And also, the alcohol must be completely dried before making the puncture, because if residual alcohol is on the puncture site, the bleeding time will be erroneously prolonged as well. And you must also initiate the timing of the procedure simultaneously with the puncture. It's very important, the timing of the bleeding time test. And another thing that you must remember about the bleeding time is that do not touch the wound with the filter paper. So do not put pressure when you are going to blot the wound with the filter paper, because the platelet clot may be dislodged, causing false elevated results. Next is you must check the stopwatch. It must be approximately calibrated as part of the quality assurance program, that of the timer that you are going to use for the bleeding time. And also, the direction of incision must be consistent. Remember that horizontal incision gives a longer bleeding time than a vertical incision. And another is that bleeding time may be prolonged in thrombocytopenia. Remember, low platelet count, hereditary and acquired platelet dysfunction such as von Willebrand disease, a fibrinogenemia, severe hypofibrinogenemia, and some vascular bleeding response. And also, another sources of error that you must remember about the bleeding time is this false positive result. So you remember, for the false positive results, if the BP, the blood pressure cuff, is maintained too high, usually more than 40 millimeter mercury, the incision is too deep, caused by excessive pressure or the incision device, disturbing the clot with the filter paper may also cause false positive result for bleeding time. Another is low fibrinogen, which is usually less than 100 milligrams per dL. The platelet count is low, and the most important, the most common that may affect the bleeding time is drug ingestion affecting patient's platelet function, which is aspirin. And for the false negative result, too low blood pressure cuff, usually less than 40 millimeter mercury, the inflation of the BP cuff, and too shallow incision. So that's it for the bleeding time test and the important role of platelets in coagulation or clot formation. So for the spelling reference, so I have listed some of the medical terminologies that I have mentioned during this hematology podcast for the bleeding time and platelet function for coagulation. So you may refer in this slide, von Willebrand disease, a fibrinogenemia, Bard-Parker is used in the Mielck method for bleeding time, which is the template method. SurgiCAT is another brand name for the simplate method for bleeding time, which is the most standardized method for bleeding time test. Thromboxane A2 is an example of prostaglandin that is important for ADP release. So this prostacycline also is an example of prostaglandin. So, to end this discussion, I have some few questions that you may answer if you really listen to this hematology podcast. So questions about this bleeding time test, about this topic is that, or for the platelet function in coagulation. Number one question, name the 5 steps in platelet plug formation. So if you really listen very well in this hematology podcast, then you can answer this number one question. Name the 5 steps in platelet plug formation. Number two, what are the chemicals that regulate ADP release code? So next one, you match the correct word for letter A. Causes platelets to aggregate to injury site. Is it thromboxane A2 or prostacycline? B. Inhibits ADP release so platelets do not aggregate past the area of injury. Is it thromboxane A2 or prostacycline? Next question. What effect that does aspirin have on platelet formation? So that's it for our hematology podcast. Thank you very much for listening. And please listen carefully to this hematology podcast because you may use it for future examinations. Thank you and have a good day. Bye. Please don't forget to subscribe to my channel. Like my other videos, not only about educational purposes, but I also have my travel vlogs and also lifestyle. So you may check on it for some relaxation. Thank you and good night.